Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm good. Things hurt this morning. I don't know why. Maybe I'm just getting old.
Well, should I get more specific? What hurts?
No.
Okay, we'll just let it alone.
Yeah, nothing disgusting. It's just, you know, general aches and pains here and there.
Well, you're just a young pup. Wait till it gets really old.
That's what scares me. Is I'm like, wait, I'm not that old yet.
So how's your summer been? What have you done this summer? This been fun.
We don't do a whole lot here. we got sick on vacation, and that kind of steamrolled our whole first half of summer there. My kids are doing a musical, and my one son just started on kind of intense soccer stuff. So, and this musical has taken up way more time than we ever thought it would. I don't know what the deal is with this particular director, but she likes them to rehearse a lot.
I'm sorry.
So this show better be good.
Well, you mean this show right now or that one?
That one.
Okay.
This one can stink. I can edit it, you know.
So to all of the listeners, I hope that's encouraging. Maybe we better pray and start here.
All right.
Father, thank you that regardless of our circumstances and the seasons and the age of our bodies and souls, but our spirits are still able to be quickened daily by you. And I pray that you'll quicken us and you'll draw near to us and guide our conversation. Let it be edifying and real and blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, we just did a couple podcasts on hymns, and part of me would like to carry on with that tradition. I don't know if you've noticed on the website, on the my speaker page, Joseph posted the hymn on Fanny Crosby, and it was taken, you know, from obviously our conversation here. But there are, let me think, see if I can get the numbers here. 5,000 somebody reached, and it's been shared, and it's been all over. Yeah, 5,218. And 18 likes, 26 shares. So it's been very popular.
That's awesome.
So that podcast worked well. But as I was reading through those things the other day, I also I follow Joni Erickson Tada. Mm-hmm. Have I given you the history on this broadcast of her?
I think so.
Okay.
You've known her for a while, haven't you?
Well, I don't really know her. I mean, we've met several times, and I'm going to be speaking at a conference with her in September. And I'm a big supporter of the Joni Erickson Tada ministry that's called Joni and Friends. And for those of you that have no idea who this is, I'm going to go ahead and give you just a short little bio. But her name is spelled J-O-N-I, so you would think it'd be pronounced Joni. But if I'm remembering correctly, when I read her biography, her dad wanted a boy, so it was pronounced Joni. So she was Joni Erickson. She was born in around 1950, and 17 years into her life, where she was very active. She rode horses. She was beautiful. She was an outgoing, just a picture of health. She dove into a shallow lake and she broke her neck. And this summer, and this last thing that I read says she's approaching the 50-year anniversary of life in a wheelchair. So she spent 50 years paralyzed from her neck down, and her life has touched millions of people. Her life in ministry, whether it's through wheelchairs to the world that go all over the world, 70 countries get wheelchairs, or whether it's the family retreats where families come together with that have some form of disability, oftentimes as children, but it could be an adult or a spouse. And these family retreats are held not only all over the United States, but all over the world. I'm going to be going to my third one next week. On Monday it starts. So her life has had a tremendous impact. So in the spirit of Fanny Crosby, who wrote, if you remember, it seemed intended by the blessed providence of God that I should be blind all my life. And I thank him for the dispensation. If perfect earthly sight were offered me tomorrow, I would not accept it. I might not have sung hymns to the praise of God if I had been distracted by the beautiful and interesting things about life. If I had a choice, I would still choose to remain blind, for when I die, the first face I will ever see will be the face of my blessed Savior. That's just huge. And for me, especially, if I was her dad, or if I even was her, this was not something that she was born with. This was not something, this was a quack doctor that misdiagnosed and misapplied a poultice. And so it was through his hands that she became blind. And yet, instead of cursing and becoming bitter, she has that attitude. And I don't personally think that's a sunny personality. I think that's the work of God's Spirit to help her to see his hand in it and to give him thanks. I think that's supernatural. And I say that with all my heart. So yesterday I was reading on Johnny Erickson Tata's page, and here's what she said. This is what I'm celebrating this week as I approach the 50-year mark of life in my wheelchair. My paralysis has been the sheepdog, growling and snapping at my heels, driving me down the road to Calvary, where otherwise I might not have gone were I on my feet. My troubles have enriched me with a wealth of knowledge about Jesus, knowledge that couldn't have been gained by any other means. And the same is true for you. So today, don't grumble against your trials. They are your blessings. Whew. And I don't know how to do anything except give glory to God for her, because that's God's glory in that woman's life. That's not a natural response to that kind of thing. So what do you think when you hear those words?
I'm not there yet. You know, I've heard people talk like, I've heard people talk like that, you know, at times through tragedy, and I'm just, you're right, it is supernatural. I don't want that, but a part of me, there is a little part of my soul that's like, I think that's what I need, is something that depth, but I don't think you get that without going through that kind of suffering, and I don't like suffering.
Nobody does.
Yeah.
Yeah. So don't get me wrong.
Right.
Yeah. I remember I used to have friends that would pray, you know, that they would be, have those kind of things so that they could be, and I just look at them and I'm going, part of me wants it. You know, when I read these missionary biographies of how these people knew God, there's a part of you that you want the same thing, because if this is what it takes, and you pray these prayers, but we don't really know what we're talking about, do we?
No.
And when she says blessings, it reminded me of Laura Story. Have you ever heard of her?
Yeah, but I don't remember.
Well,
what?
Her husband had an accident and he's disabled now, and she wrote a song called Blessings.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And one of the first verse starts off, we pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. Because what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if the trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Okay, so we get that, right? Maybe we don't want it. Maybe we're not embracing it, but we understand from afar. Let's put it that way.
Well, and you look at the flip side. I mean, I'm thinking, I can't remember the exact verse, but here, you know, you hear Paul talking about our trials producing perseverance and all that stuff. But then you look back at like Solomon, and he got all the blessing, and it pretty much ruined him.
Yep. Okay, so this is all introduction. It's good introduction. But this year, I've already finished reading my Bible through this year. And I'm starting again in the Old Testament. And I just finished Genesis. And I'm reading through and I'm thinking, you know what I want to do this time is I read through the Old Testament. I want to learn more about Jesus. I want to see Jesus in the Bible. So I'm going to read a couple scriptures here, because I think we might do several episodes on this. And here's how they start. As I've said many times, if I could go back in Wits End to the Imagination Station and pick any time in history that I could be there, it would be on the road to Emmaus from Luke 24, where Jesus spoke the Bible study, and he went through the Old Testament, and I'll read it. He said to them, it was Chloe and his friend, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." I don't know about you, but I would love to have been there and heard that Bible study. Then in John, he says this, talking to the people that were asking him questions. "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is they that bear witness about me." So he's reiterating that scriptures point to Christ. Then he says in another place in Luke, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. So I think maybe it's a good idea we stop and pray one more time that God will open our minds to understand the scriptures, but not just the scriptures, but to see the scriptures and how they point to Jesus. So Holy Spirit, point us to Jesus afresh today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And then John 5:46 says, "If you believe Moses, you'd believe me, for he wrote of me." And this is the work of the Holy Spirit, was to bear witness to Christ. And the Holy Spirit inspired or inspirited the scriptures. So we shouldn't be surprised that the scriptures, which were one of the greatest, I don't know if I should say that the greatest works, but one of the works of the Spirit was to men of old spoke, being moved by the Holy Spirit, says in Peter. So I'm reading through Genesis this year, and I'm wanting to understand Jesus in the scriptures. Now, I've got a bunch of stuff from the first couple chapters, but in the spirit of what we were talking about, Johnny and Fanny Crosby, the man that drew my attention as I read through Genesis this last week was Jacob. Because as I read about Jacob, I saw myself. And so in 2012, when I was going through one of the dark times of my life, I've had a couple trials, but that was one. I remember asking God, am I the only one that has to go through a trial of this sort? Or I think the word I put was, am I the only one that has to go through a crisis to understand these things and to learn these lessons? And the first person, as I prayed that prayer, that popped into my head was Jacob. And I thought about Jacob, who, well, you know, he was a piece of work. I mean, he was a deceiver, and he tricked his brother out of his birthright, and he lied to his father, and he got the blessing that was supposed to go to Esau. And, you know, he just was a piece of work. And then he goes and he lives with Laban, who, if I can use my same little phrase there, he was also a piece of work. So you got two of these tricky guys trying to trick each other, and boy, what a contest. But he finally leaves Laban, and he takes his wife and his wives and his kids and he's all his herds and everything. And, his, you know, you can read the story in Genesis, but Laban catches him, and Laban is about to kill him. He was upset because he saw that those were her girls. They weren't his wives. Those were his girls. Those grandchildren were his grandchildren, and those flocks were really his. He had a little different perspective, and he was going to kill him. And then God appeared to him in a dream and said, do not touch that man's life. So he spared his life. But then Jacob finds out that his brother Esau, who had pledged to kill him a couple decades earlier, he was on the road with 400 warriors. You know, I don't know how many warriors Jacob had, but he had a bunch of kids and he had a bunch of wives and servants, and I don't think he had 400 warriors, and he knew Esau. Esau was a stud. And so he goes up to the mountain. He's all by himself. He's totally alone. man, it's hard to even say this. It's hard to be alone like that. And you got everything on the thing. And he goes up that mountain and he wrestled with God's angel all night and he wouldn't let go. And it changed his life because he went up Jacob. And before he was done, God had named him Israel. And I haven't added up the verses yet, but I think Jacob might be one of the most significant characters in Genesis, because Abraham had large chunks and Joseph had large chunks, but Jacob kind of spanned both of them. And we see a man that went through it. And then later he had other trials, but still, so the point was he was in a crisis. And that comforted me because he was changed. But now let me go back. So where was Jesus in that? And this is one of the things that I've learned about Jesus in this last couple of years is that it says in Isaiah, in all their afflictions, he was afflicted. It says in John, when he was at the tomb of Lazarus, it said Jesus wept. And I don't think Jesus is separated from us. I believe that when we weep, he weeps. And when Jacob was suffering, he was suffering. And so I want to bring those two thoughts in there today, is that God meets us in the valleys. He just does. And he redeems us. And Jacob became a new man, and the tribe of Israel, the Israelites started right there because he was Israel. And let me just do one more while I'm at it. So Jesus is with him in the valley. Jesus is with Johnny Erickson Tata in the valley. Jesus is with Fanny Crosby in the valley. Jesus is with Laura Story in the Bible. In her valley. Jesus is with us in our valleys. And that's the other thing is that there are several times in the scripture, many times, that's one of the greatest promises we have is, I will be with you. And we have promises. Abraham got that promise. Isaac, we're going to document that later. But so the first thing is Jesus is with us. And then I started thinking about when my son, John, J-O-H-N, was born. And he's having his 30th birthday in 2 weeks. So I'm doing some reflecting. And I'm remembering that for those 2 years, here I am right now. I'm zipping through the Bible. I've already read it through once this year, this is only the second time I've ever read it this fast. And I'm reading through Genesis again. I'm in a good place. But back when Johnny was born in 1987, I was not in a good place, and I didn't read my Bible through that year. In fact, for 2 years, I lived in the Psalms. That was home for me. I wasn't on top. I was struggling. I was surviving, and I wasn't going to the Scripture to find Jesus. I wasn't going to the Scripture to receive new insights into God's plan. I was going to the Scripture for survival. Have you ever had those kind of days? When you just open your Bible and you're just looking for comfort. Psalm 23, I think, is probably one of the most read scriptures, especially in hotel rooms. You know, the Gideon Bibles, they have a little section in there for comfort when you're afflicted. So here's some scriptures that I read in the Psalms in 1987 that really helped me when I was in the valley. First one, Psalm 34:18, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. When I hear of people that are suffering to this day, this is what I pray for them. Father, be near to the brokenhearted. Be a very present help in trouble. Because those scriptures, they're just packed with promise. And the main thing is God's presence. Psalm 55:22 changed my life. Cast your burden on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never permit the righteous to be moved. When I read that verse, it allowed me to lay my burden down. I don't know how to tell you this, except that when I was really going through it, there was a part of me was just trying to hold my life together. And I have an image of my mind of my arms wrapped around myself, just trying to hold my life together, just trying to get through day to day. And I was afraid to really open up and tell people, to tell God, to tell anybody what I was really going through, because I was afraid I'd fall apart, be like Humpty Dumpty, and all the king's horses wouldn't be able to put Steve back together again. I didn't articulate that, but I knew what I was doing. I was just, I had a shell up. I had my arms around me, and I was just keeping everybody at arm's length because I needed to just protect myself. And when I read that verse, cast your burden on the Lord, he will sustain you. He will never allow, one version says, or suffer or permit. He forbids the righteous to be moved. Forbid, I'm adding that word. But the whole idea is he guaranteed me when I read that verse that if I will pour everything out on him, he'll take care of me. And so I set an appointment in my mind. Saturday morning, I was done working for the week. I went into my bedroom, locked the door, knelt down by my bed, and I just poured out my heart to God. And he met me. And that's when I began to heal. And then the last verse is Psalm 68:19. It says, blessed be the Lord who daily bears us up. God is our salvation. And this is the most wonderful part about Jesus is when we walk through the valley, when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. And that's the great promise in Scripture. And that's what, by the way, Jesus' name, when he came to us in the New Testament, he says, Emmanuel, which means God with us. That's the great message of Genesis to me. That's the great message of Fanny Crosby and Johnny Erickson Tada, my own testimony, that when we walk through the valley, he'll be with us. And he'll redeem us, and he'll help us. And that's something that I want to see in Genesis more and more, and throughout the Old Testament. I want to see all the places, because I used to read those verses and think, this is like messianic prophecies, like Isaiah 53 prophesying the crucifixion, and you think about the verses that prophesy why he would come from Bethlehem and why. But now I have a bigger, how should I say it, a bigger lens, so to speak. And when I go through Genesis, I want to see Jesus afresh. And I want to see Jesus in Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers, and that's what we're going to talk about. But one of the things I see of Jesus in Genesis is being with Jacob, being with Abraham, being with Joseph when he was in the prison for 12 years or whatever he was, and God is with us. Amen. What do you think there, Scott?
I think it's the difference between just reading words and having the Holy Spirit open them to you. I think that's the difference between just studying a book of, you know, old writings and having God himself speaking to your heart. And I don't know the three steps to making that happen other than to sit down and ask him and then wait on him, you know.
You have a great heart. Okay, so this is something that I've been thinking about too, because when I finished up the New Testament like 2 weeks ago, I read, by the way, the reason I read so much of Genesis was I had a 2.5-hour trip and Johnny was snoring beside me in the car, so I just put my phone on and I listened to it. And it's a great way to listen to Scripture and read it, and, you know, not while you're driving. But when I read Hebrews, I actually read it twice, because Hebrews is Christ in the Old Testament. That's what he's doing. He's talking to these people and saying, okay, here's what you think about sacrifices, but Jesus is a better sacrifice. So I wanted to see Jesus in Hebrews. So when I'm reading Hebrews, I notice that verse that says, he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. And there's a lot of times, because you talk about a three-step process, and there are times when I go for my walks or when I'm reading the Bible and I pray, and I don't get something right away. But I like that verse that says, he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And there's something about the fact that we're seeking God that I felt like it was like I was building up my bank account. And even though I didn't get something that day, he's going to reward me for this time of seeking. And I'm just going to keep on seeking until I find. This is what the Bible also says, seek and ye shall find. But sometimes we have to seek for a long time. And that's one of the other notices that other insights that I've noticed in Genesis is, how many times do we see that God spoke to Abraham? It's like every 30 years. Now, it says he walked with God. So I think there was a communion on a regular basis and he only recorded the main ones. But still, maybe God doesn't speak to us every single second. Maybe we have to just put ourselves out and diligently seek him, but eventually he will reward us with insights. So I agree with you. I don't think it's a three-step process, and I don't think that God is going to follow our timetable. But I think it's our part to continue to pray and seek him and ask for wisdom and ask for him to open the scriptures to us, because it's a relational component. This book is a living book. It's not just the better the Greek and the better the Hebrew, you know, the more you're going to understand it. No, it's the better that the Holy Spirit opens things up to you that you're going to understand it. So not that the Greek and Hebrew won't help, but the Holy Spirit is the main thing. Okay, let's wrap this up. Father, thank you for revealing Jesus to us in the scriptures. Thank you for being near to us when we're going through trials. Thank you for being with us in the valley. I don't know what it takes for each of us, because we're all different, and you know we're different, and you created us different, and you made us unique. But I pray that you'll take these words and encourage the people that are struggling right now, that are in the valley. Those that aren't, I help you to help them to store up the golden oil and add to their seeking bank account, so to speak. But reveal Jesus to us in the Word of God. Reveal Jesus to us on a daily basis, and help us to draw near. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.